Hello everyone, I will present you in this presentation how you can design a back-end when you start a new project. The back-end is the part of the software solution where you connect to a database and the end user is not aware of the back-end, that's why it's called back-end. The user is aware of the front end. The front end is more the user interface. And the software has different layers. The front end communicates at the end to a back end. To design the back end, there is two big worlds. There is the code, which I work with C Sharp, the software, and the database, which does the persistency. And when you design the code, you design some objects as a software, and when you design the database, you design tables, you design columns, you must choose the type of the columns. So there is an interaction between these two worlds, and we will look in this presentation how we can work. Before I dig into the detail of the presentation, I speak fast about myself for 1 minute. I am Thierry Bremer, senior software engineer. I started to program in C during the college in 2000. I am an engineer since 2008. I am French, with a telecommunication engineer. I started to work in 2008 as a C developer. I have 2 experiences as a C developer. Then in 2011, I started to work as a C Sharp developer. So I have background of C Sharp developer for 10 years. And I have worked in 3 different companies. The 2 first were consulting firms where I worked in different missions. So I have a good knowledge of different environments. I've seen a lot of different architectures, structures, colleagues. In 2015, I worked at Margaux Group and worked in different financial institutions like Société Générale, Natixis, and Engie, which is more related to commodities. Then in 2020, I moved from France to Germany, in Nuremberg, and I joined GfK. I joined the technical test team of GfK, and if you are interested to join GfK, you can of course contact me. They are worldwide. About the content of the presentation, we will see the process or the methodology. We will see also the different models in C Sharp and in the database, and we will also discuss about the different tools that can be used. This is not a sequence planning. We will see a little of this 3 topics during the full presentation. About the process. First, So what I give in this presentation is advice that I can give you with my background. So, of course, everyone can work as he wants. But this is the way, this is the methodology that I propose. So the process is to try to work with test-driven development. And I will show you in the next slides more concrete things relevant to this. So with test-driven development, you start with test-driven development, and this creates C-sharp objects. So test-driven development is software. And to make your test pass, you will design a software architecture with some objects. Then, after this stage is done, I work on the SQL design to mirror the C# data structure. and we will answer different questions during this presentation. How do you convert reference from C# to SQL? What about reference to a single element or list of elements? How do you convert inheritance from C# to SQL? And then, once you have created a new database, you must adapt the C# code, which by design was not at the beginning connected to a database, and you will have to modify it to connect to the database. So we will see the methodology to modify the C# code to use the database, and see the different tools that can be used to access the content of the database with C# code, and what do you add in your project to interact with the database. So there is, like TDD, in TDD you have the tests which enhance the target code. This presentation is not about TDD. There are a lot of presenters which know very good how to present TDD. But so here we are more in this interaction. So we have C# software. So in this presentation, I say C# code is client code. Client code in the sense that I am client of the database. So you have client code, which can be designed. Then, so this is step one. Step two, you design models in SQL. Then, because you have some tables in the database, you will modify C# code. You will see some problems, and maybe you will interact and change the database schema, and then vice versa. And you make a loop during this. So this is as early stage of a new project, and there is you can do this iteration process because there is not a lot of data in SQL, and you can reset very easily the full database content. I propose to call this the primer process. You can also you can understand this as a startup process or how to start a project. The step one, I create a proof of concept as offline console application. And this console application is designed with TDD, test-driven development. We design the dependencies of console application via TDD. Then, in step two, you design SQL model, update application SQL model in different iterations. This is what I just showed in the previous slide, but this is written in another way. Then you design the repository via TDD with direct connection to the database. What this means? This means you design a repository. Repository, this is a part of the client code. You design a software code via TDD also to connect and to send objects in the database and to collect them from the database. So there is two parts of TDD. There is a first TDD to design offline application, then you will create the repository also with TDD. Then at step three is you can begin step three with instantiate the content of the database by saving hard-coded dataset of stage one. So here you will try to create dataset to have an offline console application. Then you create a repository which makes input output to the database, and you can amorce or start the content of the database with the content of the console application, which were hard-coded, and push them to the database. And then create a connected mode of application using the repository defined in this step. I will speak now about the C# model on building the database schema. So what I will present you is different principles, but they are oriented on a real personal project that I have worked on. And I will first explain you what this project intends to do. So I have a console application here, which is an offline console application. And Here the output is the log output. And I will read the different. So before reading these lines, I will just tell you what it intends to do. It intends to connect to a website, grabbing the content of a specific page, extracting the content of a specific location of the page. Once this is extracting, applying a verification on the content, and depending on the verification, it will notify a component. For example, it can call back a web service or send an email. In this output, there is two different process. So one process is for one. So there is two websites which are displayed. The first website is here. So I'm downloading some. So this is a name, high level name. This is the website. I download the content. The content is saved. Then I extract some data inside the content. I extracted the price here. Then you have text to number extractor. The input is a string here. The output is a number. Then I say I managed to extract this price. Then there is a checker here. The checker inspects if this price is below a given number. It says true, and then a notification is triggered. Notification is triggered, and then I do this for another website. So the website here is downloaded. I download, I extract something. I extract a price here. The output is a number here. And I check if 100 is above 105. This is not correct. This is false. The pipeline is done, but there is not any notification contrary to this point. So you understood the global ID of the software. What I propose to you is that you pause the video before the next slide and you try to design a class diagram to see which class you will design, which reference to which class you would design, if you make some inheritance, how do you handle the extractions part, how do you handle the conversion, how do you handle the notification. So try to work on this and or think now if you are fast, and then continue the next slide. So I go now on the next slide and will show the class diagram that I have designed. Before the class diagram, these are the unit tests which have been designed in the same time of the console output. So you see here different tests. The presentation is not about designing test-driven development, so I will not explain deeply how to do it, but just that you are aware of this console application is covered by 105 tests. Here you have the solution where I have my console application with a reference to the core objects, and the core are unit tested. Here is a class diagram that I have for the offline console application. So here I have a trox. A trox is the root object which handles the different dependencies to other objects. It has a dependency. So this is a UML class diagram. So the way that you read UML class diagram is that you have an arrow with an open end arrow. This means that you have a reference. And the name which is above the arrow here, downloader or target, is the name of the property. So in this class, trox, I have a property which is called target, and this has a reference to an instance of an interface eWebTarget, interface web target. This web target has a reference to an enum, as a field which is web target type. This is only new, which can design either an HTTP resource, SQL resource, or direct file system. And there is other objects here. So I have a reference to the downloader to handle different protocols between HTTP, SQL, FTP, etc. Extracts chain, which implements chain of responsibility design pattern, but this is the idea that this family will extract the data which have been downloaded. Then I have a checker with a reference, a checker field with a reference to the checker interface. And then I have a reference to notifier to say which to which type of object should be called to make the notification. Here you see that I have a reference to interface web target, and these are implementation of web target. This is not the perfect UML class diagram that I like, because good class diagram I prefer to have explicit arrow with a closed end triangle. This is a diagram generated by Visual Studio. So here there is a link, I web target. And question, do you see the single responsibility principle here, SRP, which is a part of the solid principles? So you can see here one class for extraction, one specific interface to check the content, one specific class to notify. So once again, notify is, for example, you download another thing, you extract the content, you check that the content corresponds to a specific criteria, for example, is the price is equal to this number, and then I want to send a tweet, for example. This is the way it is designed. Then, once the offline console application has been designed and you have seen the different objects in the C# model, just before this, I will switch to my Visual Studio and show you here. So I have this class here that I've just presented to you. Let's zoom because the video might not show everything. And here I have, so here I have different interfaces: e-checker, notifier, extras. So the I have interface here. And here you see a name in italic. The fact that it is in italic means that this is an abstract class. So it is like an interface, but with some methods which are implemented and common to all the children. And you see here different implementation. So you have, so I'm back on the C# code here. You have, for example, the e-checker interface that is here. It has a property type which indicates which kind of checker it is. And then you have here the different children. I will come back later on why I do have a type reference here, because you will say this is a code smell, and if you make a polymorphism, you do not need this. So I will explain you why after. And here you have the same thing: extracts abstract class. Same thing with the reference type to the type, and then the different implementation. For example, this will extract the content between two keywords. Here, this will extract the content before a given keyword, and this will extract the content after. All these projects, when you understand a little the principle, can be understood as a framework of no code. The goal is that the user will use the project that I design, and by configuring it, will be able to extract the different things which can be downloaded. This was a little word about, because there is a, I've seen a video the other day about the no code fashion. No code fashion is the fact that you use a specific framework to design a specific project without you writing any single line of code. And this, you see here there is a reference to the class itself. Next, and you see also the method name, which is called getOutputChain. This is on getNext. This is here. Do you know, when you look at this, you just forget this, and I would say, do you know, do you recognize here which design pattern it is by just looking at the class diagram? So I let you think, and the result is the chain of responsibility, because you have a look back to your class and you have this get next and get chained thing, set next. Okay, there is a video that I've made on chain of responsibility, which explains more deeply what is design inside. You can see it later. So, once you have a clear understanding of the different objects which are inside the offline console application, I use the a database designer. I chose personally the MySQL server because it's free, because it's easy to download, and I like it. There is no specific technical reason. I just wanted to try it. I tried it some years ago and I wanted to use it. And I am quite satisfied because they have an incredible tool, MySQL Workbench, that I just discovered this year. I didn't use it before. And this is a very powerful tool. You can design your DB schema, so you can create tables. Here you see at the bottom, you choose which column, which data type. And you generate the SQL code from this configuration, so you do not have to write a single line of SQL when you prepare this. And also, it can generate a model. It can reverse a model. It shows also a diagram of the different tables, like the class diagram that I showed you from Visual Studio, and can also take as an input a SQL script and generate a diagram from this SQL script. Before continuing, I will show you fast the content of this MySQL designer. So here you have the different tables. For example, double click on this one, so you see here. And at the same time, you have the diagram which correspond to the different tables. And you see here, in fact, the link between the C# world. So I did this after having designing the C# code with TDD. And the added value to do this is that the objects have been designed, and I create the tables to mirror the objects. So you have here the trucks, here you have the extracts definition, which corresponds to the extracts abstract class, the checker definition, and the notify definition. Here you see again the same thing that are here. It download extracts, checker, notifier. extracts, checker, notifier. And all the diagrams are organized the same way. Extracts is at the top. So the way you read this diagram is that you come from the top and there is a sequential order here in the process. So I first work with the web target, then I extract data, then I check the content of the data, then I notify. Let's continue what I wanted to say. At the beginning I was saying I will present you different things and we'll speak about the different tools. So this is the tool. The fact to design it, to have the diagram of the tables is extremely powerful and very, very, very nice to work with. Once you start to create models in the database, once the model in the database has been created, you start to work on the C# code which connects to the database. So you start to create a repository, and you can be I have been confronted to problems, to technical problems. For example, I designed the e-checker. E-checker was designed as an interface with object-oriented principles. So it exports one method, the method check. The fact as is that as I have different implementation of this checker, the different implementation might have some different construction parameter. You are confronted in the database to the dilemma. How will you put inside? So let's take for example this e-checker. Let's think about it. You have checker. If you have different parameters depending on the objects which implement it. So here I have for example a text, a number is less, a number is greater, a number is equal. If you want to store everything in the same database, in the same table, try to think about it. How you will implement the fact that one object which will take in the constructor text to contain checker. One input, for example a reference pattern, a reference token. Here number is equal checker, one input is number to a given number. Here is less, you must handle the fact that it can be less or equal. So I have two inputs, the reference on the a boolean flag, bool true or false. And there is different other things. There is a problematic. If you want to construct your object, you must handle something to inject the parameters inside the constructor. This, I've seen it during the creation of the repository part. When you try to insert data and take it back, and you will see, I see it, the impact that I need two parameters here. Number is greater, I want a reference, and a boolean to say if it is equal. Of course, I could design another thing with another object, which a specific object is a strict greater or less strict greater, etc. But the same problematic will have occurred on other type of object. I want to stress here that by creating the repository, the prototype which has been designed in the very first stage of the console application is challenged. And this is what I wanted to show during the first slide. Here I am designing the SQL database, and by creating the C# repository, I have to modify the C# model and interact again to change the content of the table. So here, what everything that I show is solved, but you can easily think that the first version was not exactly so the first version of the database was not exactly what I am now showing to you. I am a little lost in my different slides, so I come back again to this slide. And so my initial interface of checker in my first stage was only with line 5. So the interface has just a check method as a public. So this is why I written legacy. And then during the implementation, needed, you see here the comment needed for DB insertion. So I need a database ID. I need a type field, which will define which kind of object must be instantiated, and the best way to handle multiple inputs is to put a string encoded serialized as JSON. So this is a new interface which has been updated, and you might challenge the idea that the type property here is maybe a code smell. There is different arguments of can you put this inside this a type inside a checker, because there is this notion about open close principle, and if you put an enum inside this, it is less open. Technically, it is inside this interface because of the factory. Try to think. So, do you think type properties code smell suggests me a way to handle persistency? Yes. The thing is that you can design architecture without this field if you create, for example, a desktop application, and when the desktop application is closed, there is no persistency. So, if everything is in memory and you close the process, okay, maybe you can work without this field. The thing is that I'm working with a database, I need persistency, and technically, you cannot say, I want to construct this type of object without knowing it. So to be more concrete, you load data from database, you have a checker table. How do you do to say which checker object you will instantiate without knowing the type? It is impossible. And the factory design pattern instructs you to put an enum of the kind of type of object you want to create. Object models for DB interaction. Okay, so now there is another point which I worked on. The fact that you can handle multiple inputs. For example, this type of object. So there is some objects which can handle multiple input. And to answer this problem, I have chosen to have a principle of design through all the software architecture. I create a dedicated type to contain all containing all the fields needed to create an object. So if I want to create an object XXX, I will create a specific type called XXXArg. I implement the XXX object on its constructor text XXXArg for input that you see here. After extracts text as input after arg. Or I could write after extracts arg. But, on XXX exposes a JSON arg getter, which you see here. It is overriding because I am with an abstract class. A JSON arg, which return, I use here in my own serializer generic to generate the string which is used in the during the DB insertion process. And during the DB loading process, I load the content of the tables, deserialize it with an external component to deserialize, then construct my argument and put it here. You could say in a stage I was asking me will I put a JSON string here. I tried it. The fact is that it is too much open and I do not like it. I prefer to ask for a specific type and not as a developer try to think which kind of JSON string I should construct dynamically for this kind of object. This is a matter of choice. You can challenge it and say I prefer to construct with only JSON and parse it inside my object. This is the way I acted. So one more time here, you see that because of a single column to take, not a single column, because of implementation problems, I changed my initial design. The initial design was, for example, some constructor was taking two parameters. Now every class takes a single parameter, which is like this. Then, also, I have seen, so in C-sharp you have inheritance, but in the database world you can translate inheritance in at least two ways that I will show to you. The first way is that you have all children that are stored in the same table. The different input is handled by a JSON column. This is just the slide that I showed you previously. The downside of this, so this is the first example. I have notify elements and reference here to the notify type. I will speak later about this type. This is like an enum. This acts like an enum. MySQL handles enum. I do not want to handle enum inside this because I know that other database system does not allow enum. So I prefer to design a system which can be easily transferred to another kind of technology. And you will see in the next slides why what is added value of this. So here I have a table and so the notify type, so the kind of children is referenced by the ID notify type here. And all the children are stored in this table. The downside is that you cannot SQL query on specific input value. For example, you cannot say, I want each child who has as a parameter one X value, for example. This is the downside of this solution to implement in the database side inheritance. The second solution is that you create one table per children, per type of children, per class, Each input is in a dedicated column. So here, for example, this can be used where number of parameters between children is high or when query on specific parameter might be done. So for example, to handle the web targets, I decided not to use this kind of things with the JSON. Where is the JSON? In fact, the JSON is here. This is the varchar. Right. I've decided to have my web target table with a link to the ID web target, ID web target type, which is here, ID target type, which gives the kind, the name of the target. So this is HTTP, SQL, etc. And then in each table, I have a reference here to the corresponding data. So here, if I have, for example, a HTTP target in with ID web target 1, there will be an entry in this table with a ID web target 1. And nothing in this table will have ID web target 1. So there is foreign keys here referencing this table. So this is the database diagram of the proof of concept, which I have already showed to you, and you see here. So this, one more time, this is one of the final version. So you have the different kind of web targets with one table for HTTP, one table for SQL, and here for the extracts, I have all the components inside the same table, and same thing here, all the kind of checkers, all the implementation possible of checker here, and same thing below. I can show it here. The notification, all the implementation of notification will be here. Okay, how MySQL works, there is two very interesting functionalities. There is the forward engineer that generates SQL code to create a DB schema from designer. This can be used, for example, you work on the designer, you say I want to create, for example, I will add, there is this, for example, can say I want to create a new table category. Okay, then you have this, so you can link it, add some columns. For example, I will add colon x66 and say it is a varchar or big int. Okay, and then yes, okay, and then you have this file export forward engineer, and this creates SQL script that you can after insert in the database. And you have the reverse engineer script, which takes the, and I will show it to you. I will show it to you. So here, what you see is the design. I have it, but I want to show you. At least this is interesting to see. I want to reverse engineer SQL script, and I will reverse engineer my SQL script, which has been generated by the workbench itself. You will see I execute it. Next, finish. What it is? Well, the thing is that wait, I prefer to don't save. So I will start again. Start. Where do I do this? Why do I do this? Fine. I must open a designer. New model. So I have a new model here, and I do file. Import reverse engineer. My SQL like this. Next. Fini. What is it? I wanted to show the model. Okay. I restarted the workbench and I found I was in the wrong place. So you must go to the database, then reverse engineer here. And I connect to my database. So you do not need the SQL script. You connect directly to the database. I select my database that I want to reverse. Reverse engineer selected object, placed objects on diagram. Finished. Finish. And here, my database has been reversed and the diagram has been generated. And this is extremely powerful. So, the downside is that I worked a lot in the previous diagram to organize them. And here you see a raw output. So, you see here, for example, if I try to put it in the same way, I have my extract type, I have my truck that I have here, my checker are below, my notify should be below, my checker, the checker type should be next to checker def, my web target, this is at the top, my web target type, this is here, I have web target HTTP, I have my extraction which should be here, my extraction type, my checker def, so this is like a little puzzle for the children. Notify type, but you understood the principle. Just want to play a little with this to show you, but it is extremely powerful. I didn't have the opportunity to work on this tool, but if you work on a new project which is on MySQL, you can use this tool and have a very nice view of the system with this. So, this is finished, you understood the principle. Okay. So, let's come back to the slide, because I speak a lot. The thing is that as I am registering this offline on my PC without an audience, without any chronometers, I can take my time. So, my SQL workbench. Good. You understood it? So, now I speak about the repository, even if I earlier talked about it. Let's give some definition. What is the definition of persistency? Persistency is the life of object is not finished when the process or the machine is shut down. So this is another way to say the object is saved in the database. Repository definition. An independent project, technically a CS proj, in a solution, technically a SLM, which manages the persistency layer with the input-output being exclusively business objects. And the persistency config, I mean by this persistency config, I mean the connection string or any mechanism which can link to the hardware, to the hard layer. The code using the repository should never use SQL code if your low layer is a database. Any feature or persistency layer should not be available outside the repository, except maybe the connection or the transaction. A repository can access to a database, or indirectly via a web service, the user is not aware the way the repository manages persistency. We have two main problems with the repository which is used by the client code. Name of the fields in the database might be different than the legacy C# objects. The C# object might be immutable with some read-only properties or specific constructor, while the DB filler the code which will create the objects must have access to mutable objects. Why? Because of mapping techniques that I will show you after. Implement manually link between tables and objects is stupid. Example, fine. So I'm sure you've already seen some code where you see a SQL query is done, and then with the result you have field A equals row 0, then field B equals row 1, field C equals row 3 with some things. So these are main problems when you create a repository. Solution that I propose. And this is one very specific topic of this presentation. This is here the core of the presentation, very something very important. I will use Entity Framework, but Entity Framework is a little big. I will not use Entity Framework inside my repository. I will use Entity Framework to generate only automatically the objects model from the database models once. So Entity Framework is a framework. I'm not an expert about the Entity Framework, but just keep in mind that this is a big framework which can handle the database connection. I do not use it because there might be some complex issues when it is too much complex. But I will show you what it can do. And to answer this point, I use Dapper dependency to fill objects with content of database. Dapper makes stupid work. Is good. Well, the entity framework. Okay, entity framework do some stupid work. Connect to the database and prepare for me the objects for mapping. So, I have objects in my other repository, but my in my other projects. But the repository to make a good mapping of the database must have C-sharp objects which correspond to the model of the database. For example, here you see checker minus def. Oops. This is because I have checker minus underscore def. So each table with each of the column has a correspondency to a specific object with the column. And this object, which is the exact mirror of the content of the database, has been generated via Entity Framework. Once image of database is created in C#, the mapping must be done, so you use Dapper. So I will speak about this after. I just want to show you live what it looks like. So I have here a command prompt. I have here my repository. And I have in another place, I will find it, some shortcut to execute. Yes, to show you. So I have entity framework like this. And so what I'm going to call now is let me just, I am really not, this is not the best way to present, but I'm changing some config. Okay, good. So, and you know what, because you are looking the video, I am not alone on the computer. I will put like this, I will say 20. Okay, so you see better. Yes. So there is some setup to do. I will not explain exactly how to set up the .NET entity framework, etc. But the idea is that you give a connection string here. So I have my database, the identification, okay. And I say I want to use this thing. So this component here in the command parameter, say I want to use MySQL connector. You can, so it is possible to use different database system. And this is minus O DB model. This is the namespace of the target place of the in my solution that I want to generate. And you can say use database names because by default, so you must put this because by default the database names are modified. The tables are not exactly the same. The columns, I think, are not maybe the same. No, I think it's the name of the tables which are not, maybe the underscore are not conserved. On minus force, it means even if this exists already in my solution, I can force it. But as my solution is working, I will, for the demonstration, try to show you with another one, DB model. So you see here, I have my a solution with my DB model with my CS proj, my CS files. Okay, I will say DB model, let's say Thierry, and we go. So it is connecting to the database, and this thing also. Try to compile. So this is not. I don't know why he tries to compile, but he wants to compile. And the fact is that if your solution does not compile, it does not allow you to generate the objects, which I hope it will generate. So, okay. So here you see that the directory has been created with all the tables and the columns. If I try to look at this one, so I have these tables with the different fields. If I want, for example, to open, let's say the checker, checker def, let's say open the checker def, okay, and if I take the if I take I am lost here checker def checker def checker def checker def here I open this and you see that my checker def has so you see the link so we have id checker def as int id trucks order order it is nullable here because what I do not know but this is not a problem id checker type arg varchar arg is string okay so what I want to stress is that this is an extremely powerful technique to generate automatically the C# code to mirror the content of the database. And this is a technique that I advise you to do. Because I'm sure I've done it, and maybe you have done it, spend some time to generate manually some specific objects to mirror the a specific table, then to map it. So, I hope that you see the added value of this. Once I have a mirror of the table, we use Dapper. Dapper is a dependency that you can download on NuGet. There is Tim Corey on YouTube who has published very interesting video. I will show you fast the principle of Dapper, and I advise you to Look at this video, which are extremely interesting and complete. He will speak more detail. He gives more detail than me. The ID of Dapper, and you will see how the technique can be useful. I will show you some tests. So some tests are failing because I'm still in design, but some tests are working, and I will show you a simple example. For example, do I have a lot? Let's take this one. Get all extracts. Okay. So get all extracts. The principle of this test is that it's a single extract. Ah no. So this test is calling this method get all extracts. This method is inside the repository. So in my repository, I have a method which says I give you an input, a trox ID, which is a main object I showed you before, and I want to see every dependency which are linked to this trox ID. To do this, I have to write down the specific SQL query, then look at this line. In a single line, I manage to say I want to execute this query, I give you a mapper, I give you a param object, which is in fact giving the content of the object which is referenced inside the SQL query, and then as I have ID type here, yes, and because this query is making a join between two tables, extracts def and extracts type, I tell Dapper that the two objects are defined here, which has been created by the previous step that I followed to you, I showed to you, and in the result, the two objects are separated when the ID type field is seen. So the Dapper extracts will take as input the extracts def object, the extracts type object, which come from the database, which has been filled up by Dapper with this query, and this mapper tracks must output a extracts definition object. So if I go to the mapper extracts, I forgot to zoom on it. So I have my two database objects, which come from the query. Then I create my output object with this. And all my code are things like this. I have a mapper, I have notify mapper, and then you have the queries. I want to execute the query. And here, this is in fact an extraction method provided by Dapper. If you look at inside this definition, this should be an extension method here. You see, I don't know who created this this library, but he should have some fun. And you have generic method like this. So you imagine the work which has been done. And this is extremely powerful because, in fact, what you use here, you just use a minimum. You just use SQL query. So this line might look a little complex, but look at the work that you avoid to do by mapping every fields of the database with the field of the object you want. So on Dapper, the example is showed here with select, but you can insert, update, do everything. So look at the video of this guy if you want to see more explanation of Dapper. One thing I've told you is that we designed everything with TDD, and one of the techniques that I propose you to do, in addition to all the work that I explained you, is to make one automatic test which I define as a round trip. So the definition of round trip is a round trip is a powerful integration test of the repository layer. I create a transaction where a full object is created in memory. I save it in the database via one of the methods or the methods of the repository to save it. Then I load back from the database with one of the methods of the repository to load the content of the database. Transaction is rolled back, and then integrity between original and final object is checked. And here you see a very nice example where I have the save method, which is green. I have the get method, which are green. On the round trip, say, I want to save a truck, this one. I want to load it. It should be the same. And this is red. So try to do this kind of round trip, and this kind also avoid interesting bugs. Then, when I am at the last stage of the presentation, I will speak about enum integrity. Still in the test battery, I propose to create an enum integrity checking process. So enum integrity, what is an enum integrity? It's a verification that codes are identical between the client code, so the C# code, and the database. Enum must be used instead of hard-coded integer, so this is obvious. A J, it means, for example, animal dog in the code should be used instead of 4. This is obvious, but this is less obvious in the database. Sometimes you see database with a hard-coded value without any correspondency in the database, and this is very something dangerous that I discourage. If database does not support enum type, a specific table between numbers and names must be defined, one table per enum type. In fact, even if MySQL handles enum, I prefer to use this, and I will show you why. The enum integrity must be done at software startup and added to test battery. So, test battery, it is the minimum. When I wrote this, I didn't finish the software, so this might be a little big. But if you want to be sure that you have no mixing values, you can try to put it. So, this is one idea. Maybe not mandatory, but this is mandatory. Try to add the enum integrity in the test battery, and I will show you some illustration. So here, for example, I have a test which is failing. The test is check enum, and the way I name it is that I have a generic check enum for each type of enum. Then I give the name of the enum. So I have an enum which is called checker type. And this test is failing. Why? Because the test says, look, checker type is less as a code which is different between the database. So, and you see, the client has a code 0, the database has code 1. 1, 2, 2, 3, 3. So there is a little of, there is an offset of 1. And this is one illustration of the usefulness of this kind of test. So here you understood obviously the root cause. The root cause is that the root cause of this, when you know the code, is that the enum has been written in the C sharp code with no default value. So it is starting by zero, and in the database, when you insert data, you start with the one ID. So the offset comes from there, and you correct it just by forcing the value of the enum in the code. Enum integrity must be done at software startup and added to test battery. So this is what I just told you. Example of integrity failed. What about missing value? So in the slide before, I showed you an offset. And here, I show you another example. So you see this test now is passing. And other tests are failing. And why? Because in fact, there was a mix between the client code and the database. For example, my checker type enum, the value web callback has a code of 1 in the client code and a code of 3 inside the database. So here you change. So this is the default value with starting with 0. Here you see the difference with the database. So this is corrected. This makes this test pass. Okay. Also, during the writing of the unit test, I started to try to write this enum test, and it led me to a change of design because I had a column name which was different for each type. Here I had initially, so you see it here, notify type, which correspond to an enum. I defined it in this table as notify type, ID notify type. The problem is that I want to generate code which is generic to check the enum. So I created this check enum generic, which takes as input the enum of the client and the type of the database. The generic and the input is the name of the table. The problem when you try to do this is that you should have database table which have the same interface. So to do this, I change the way I designed the tables and renamed all of them and removed the type of enum in the name of the field. So ID notify type is changed to ID type. And for each type, I have a column ID type, ID type, ID type. Okay. And this permits to create a specific interface, enumdef, which can manually be inserted inside the model which has been automatically generated by the stage of the entity framework. When I say this, I will just give you an illustration to show you what I mean by this. So I have my repository and my type here is inheriting from an enum def. And I added manually this for each kind of type. So extract type as this. If I look at the web target type, this also as this, and the notify type as this. And this, if you look, this is a specific interface that I've created for this purpose. And to continue my illustration, so we have the notify type enumdef. If we want to check about the model that I have just generated, you will see that there is no this inheritance. Notify type is here. I look in here and you see that this is not generated like this. So this is a manual action that I do because I want to have a test battery which use this generic functions to check the different kind of enemies. And these methods, so check enum, checker type, notify type, web target type, extract type, are in the low level calling this generic check enum generic. And you see here enum integrity must check that all values of the client code are declared in DB. The code of the generic check also checks, so it is failing here because the enum length of text has no correspondence in the database. One another illustration of how the integrity enum is useful. Oops, I was here. Some nice error really occurred. So every screenshot that I show you with the red was a real error, a real bug that I spotted with a test, automatic test. Use case enum. So here is the use case. An enum is modified on the client code. Duplication is, so there was a duplication in fact in my enum. I had an enum and I have one entry which was called isLess. And one other entry for number is less, and it was a duplicate. And I removed the is less in the client code without updating the DB. And the code say, look, integrity failed, checker time number is greater, different code. No, here, checker type requested value is greater was not found. Okay, you see it, error. Cannot parse value is less to enum, checker type requested value is less was not found. So here you see, it means I have is less in my database and I cannot parse it. I don't know it. So it says this. Do you still think enum integrity checking is necessary? So maybe you are thinking, oh, he's making too much work. But what are we doing when I am checking this? In fact, because I have this property field type, which is mandatory for the factory, for the persistency, and because this field is the information of the different children, for example, text do contain as an entry here. Text do contain. What it is doing? What are we doing when I we are making enum integrity? The type property is on enum, so this is what I say. By checking enum integrity, a check of all implementation is done because of bijection between enum size and class families. So this is why this is extremely important and powerful, this kind of check in the code. Same thing here. I have some different implementation of the class, and I have an enum here, and I check my test, which will check the integrity of the enum, just check that my client code is synchronous with the content of the database. This is extremely powerful. So, this was a slide from the beginning, so we can answer some questions. Test-driven development defines C-sharp objects. So, I didn't speak about test-driven development, but you understood that it is extremely powerful. SQL design to mirror C-sharp data structure. How do you convert reference from C-sharp? I didn't speak specifically about this, but you understood that there was a foreign key inside this. What about references to single element or list of elements? In fact, you make an inversion of references. You make a foreign key on the child elements to reference the ID of the main element. You can see this, come back on the slide and see how the objects are designed. How do you convert inheritance from C# to SQL? And here, you see that there is I speak about two different techniques with the use of the enum integrity. Add C# code to use database. Which tool do you use to access the content of the database with C# code? So, we use MySQL Workbench to generate the SQL code initially. Then, I use Entity Framework to create C# code inside it. I use the Dapper tool also to create my repository. I use test-driven development to enhance my repository in C#. In the context of this test-driven development, I, for example, as an illustration, I had to change my SQL schema to change the enum tables with to comply with a single interface. So I have to change again my SQL code. Once this has been done, I had to update my run again entity framework to generate again the new schema. And this is it. What do you add in your project to interact with the database? So I added a reference to Dapper, and I added the different objects which have been created by Entity Framework automatically. And this is the result after the implementation of the repository. You have on the left the legacy unit tests, which were executing successfully in the offline console mode. And during the creation of the repository, you have the different repository tests, which can be updated after, but this gives a lot of security in the code using the database. You can continue the once the repository is passing all the tests, you can try to so this has been commented, but this has been run once. So watchlist create local. So this was during the offline mode. So I do not want to use the offline mode anymore. I commented it. Then I made a first run with save watchlist, used once to initiate the database content with the offline mode. So in fact, I was creating the watchlist, then saved it, then commented it, and then run it again to try to load the content of the database. And this is the this is the step of the stage 3 that I given you at the beginning when I say I try to migrate the offline mode to the connected mode by using the repository. And this is finished for today. This was a very long presentation with a lot of technical stuff. You can contact me on my mail. I will put the slide at the end again, this one. And I hope that you have discovered very interesting thing. And write me in the comments of the YouTube video your questions, or how do you feel it. Thank you for your attention.